The year is 1994. Tonya Harding just won and promptly lost her US NFSC title. My dad slept through a 6.7 magnitude earthquake in the San Fernando Valley, and seeing Star Trek Generations with him is running non-existent me about $4.08 a ticket. Netscape Navigator, Boys to Men, and Ford Tauruses are all meteoric successes, and Earthworm Jim just crash-landed on SNESs all around the world. And in the midst of all of this, unbeknownst to anyone, even the company who has given it life, a once-in-a-decade, pop-culture-defining, holy-shit moment has just been ushered into the waking world, leaving only the vacuum of space in its wake as it begins its ascent into the cultural lexicon of days yet to come, like Combat Evolved or The Voyager 2. Chills. Every time. Anyway, 10 minutes down the street, in a little backlot called, Universal Studios, a David is soon to rise to the long-thrown-down, now-revitalized gauntlet of the animation world's mouse-eared Goliath. Forged in the glowing ire of Disney's recently dismissed chairman, DreamWorks, son of Jesse, who was from Bethlehem in Judah, is about to embark on a voyage lasting 4 toilsome years. The destination, their debut. 2 months, 2 features, and $389 million at the box office later, suffice to say, things pretty much work out for them in 1998. But it won't be until Y2K and their greatest failure that the studio finally strikes gold. And that's what we're talking about tonight, so put in your thinking caps and strap in. I'm Really Smart, and this is The Road to El Dorado, a match made in heaven. So before DreamWorks Animation was a 36-film, 7-franchise-deep pillar of animated features, it was DreamWorks SKG, an up-and-comer named after its trio of film boy co-founders, Steven Spielberg, Jeffrey Katzenberg, and David Geffen. Long story short, during his years at the House of Mouse, Katz didn't make a whole lot of friends, but worse, he made an extremely unfortunate enemy. Roy E. Disney, nephew to Walt, son to Roy Sr., and a force to be reckoned with on the board. Katz wanted to be prez of the whole GD kingdom, and after initially being turned down for the job, the man he was campaigning to replace ended up meeting an untimely helicopter-related death. After years of disputes over what Roy considered to be dishonoring him and the Disney legacy, though, he told then-CEO Michael Eisner, "If you make Katzenberg the president, I will start a proxy fight." And Eisner could tell he meant it. Katzenberg got the boot, successfully sued them for over 200 big ones, and hit the ground running with his revenge project modeled after and simultaneously meant to oppose Disney, a studio meant to produce widely accessible live-action features to bankroll its much less frequent, much less profitable animated features. In a very real way, Saving Private Ryan walked so the Prince of Egypt could run. And it worked. The Book of Exodus Reloaded was the second non-Disney animated feature ever to pull in over $100 million at the box office. Right behind, the Rugrats movie? Is that... Are we sure that's right? Point is, DreamWorks stuck the landing and gained a formidable foothold in the animated feature world with Ants and Initial B, proving in the process that they could match either powerhouse's style. But now the time had come to create something wholly their own, an aesthetic, or at least the framework of one. Back to 1994. With their dual debut projects now underway, it had struck Katzenberg that their next time out couldn't be Disney Goes 80s Scorsese or Manhattan as presented by Diet Pixar. So he waltzed over to the first duo of screenwriters that came to mind, Ted Elliott and Terry Rossio, fresh off a pair of back-to-back screenplays for, you guessed it, Disney. According to Ted and Ter, Katz handed them an especially thick history book authored by one Hugh Thomas, titled Conquest, Montezuma, Cortez, and the Fall of Old Mexico, and said, "This is the setting." The boys were hooked by the premise of Disney Toonami and presumably a life-changing amount of money for any normal person, and they quickly got to work scribbling down the inceptive treatment of what would become The Road to El Dorado. So, what is The Road to El Dorado? Put simply, an anti-hero-led adventure quasi-musical buddy comedy slash genre parody based on a series of films ticking the same boxes and bearing the same naming conventions beginning in 1940 with Victor Schertzinger's The Road to Singapore. Following American sweethearts Bob Hope and Bing Crosby as a pair of lovable, more stupid than they are cruel rogues, with Dorothy L'Amour invariably cast as the level-headed third and love interest, The Road to films were a collection of increasingly absurd, fourth-wall-breaking, vaudeville-channeling meta-lampoons. Each adventure embracing a new set of cinematic tropes that its creators deemed either played out or actively problematic, with the leads often addressing the audience, making fun of their own production company, or begging the Academy for nominations.
We're going with that.
Patty cake, baker's man. Baker cake as fast as
he must have seen the picture.
Get him.
For any villains we may meet, we haven't any fear. Paramount will protect us, cause we're signed for 5 more years.
And get a load of that bread and butter. Bread and butter, that's a mountain. Maybe a mountain to you, but it's bread and butter to me.
She's gonna sing, folks. Now's the time to go out and get the popcorn.
Beyond humorous, the films were antagonistic.
He won't give up! He must be a Republican!
Don't get the papers.
Is that the plot of the picture so far?
Right.
I better hide you.
From the killers?
From the critics.
And fittingly, The Road to El Dorado eventually took shape as a medley of the series' most charming elements, and as an antagonist to Disney. The duo being run out of town in The Road to Utopia, they're being mistaken as gods by the tribal leadership in Zanzibar, stowaways cast adrift in Morocco, the ancient beast in the volcano in Bali, the failure to avoid love in Singapore, the musical numbers, the progressively more grandiose set pieces, the stakes, the lies, the leading lady, and the laughs, all revivified and condensed from 7 films spanning 2 decades into 1 hour and 29 minutes of animation. And it's fantastic. So let's dive in. The film opens with a classic exposition in the lyrics title sequence, set to its titular theme, El Dorado, sung by Elton John and co-composed by Tim Rice and Hans Zimmer. The same Elton John, Tim Rice, and Hans Zimmer responsible for the Lion King soundtrack the same year Cats was dropped from the kingdom. Which isn't petty at all. Beyond it being an absolute banger, though, there's a couple pretty bold deviations from the at-the-time status quo taking place with this introduction. First and most evident, Ejon's crystalline vocals aren't being delivered to us from a second or third person perspective, either limited or omniscient, like the majority of animated feature, narrated prologue sing-alongs are. The lyrics, instead, are coming from a first-person perspective, but not from the characters leading the film, either. In fact, the theme doesn't establish that any characters exist at all, and none of our cast appears in the visuals which accompany it. Second, sex is a decidedly existent thing in the world we're being transported to, which is crazy. For years, the closest Disney ever came to sex in their animated features was this weird phallic shape my friend showed me on the cover of our family's VHS of The Little Mermaid, and your pick of one of the 6 times I can think of where Disney made an animal give another animal this look. And while neither of these immediate oddities necessarily scream rebellion from the jump, they're each introductions to themes which The Road to El Dorado continuously iterates upon over and over again until, by its end, the film very much does feel like it's deliberately sailing against the wake of an incomparably large animated galleon. Anyways, as the introduction reaches its end and Elton's voice fades from our presence, we're ushered into 16th century Spain, in the beginning of our slap-happy adventure, by the gentle hum of flowing water. Brilliant, blue, inviting, agua purificada. As the camera begins to pan away, a hand clutching a silver goblet plummets through the frame into the fountain where the stream ends, and as it's pulled back to meet its owner's face, we come with it, introducing us to the film's first character. The resounding voice of Jim Cummings pierces through the wave of growing applause and trumpetry as the date card fades. The grim, steel-clad figure sat imposingly above us as he announces to the crowd that today he sails to conquer the new world.
of Spain.
Already, this introduction is super solid. Like the way it cuts from this really high angle shot to one where we've been cast to the back of the crowd and right before cutting in close again, his eyes briefly rest on us? Or the classic staring at the object you're holding while you say something menacing thing that villains like to do? Or the soldiers surrounding... I got a little ahead of myself there. This guy's... a villain. The villain. The film opens on an introduction of its antagonist after a ballad from the perspective of someone living in the world he's setting off to destroy. And adding a great deal to this gravitas, this particular villain isn't the product of anyone's imagination, either. It's Hernan Cortez, one of the worst people to have ever drawn breath, most well known for leading the genocide of the Aztec Empire, resulting in its total decimation. This guy was so evil that one of the defining moments of Arthas Menethil's descent into insanity in Warcraft 3 Reign of Chaos, itself based on Fëanor's burning of the Teleri Swan ships in Lasgar in Tolkien's The Silmarillion, is something that Cortez actually did. So determined in his zeal to kill natives instead of return home and give his men no other choice but to help him do it, that he cast his ships aflame. Or ran them aground, nobody really knows for sure, trapping them and himself in the Americas. Within these first few shots, directors Don Paul and Eric Bergeron subvert the accepted order in which Disney and Disney adjacents had customarily introduced their casts. Protagonist appears first in the film or in its book-ready overture and convinces us of our villain's villainy, mostly through composition and his interactions with his horse. Speaking of his horse, Altivo, this also marks the introduction to our first supporting character, his horse, Altivo. We'll circle back to him in a minute. After Cortez throws his now half-empty chalice behind him, the camera once again accompanying it, we're introduced to our protagonists, after a match fade through their wanted poster as they're throwing dice in an alley. T&M have cleaned house and are about to bounce when the man they were gambling with offers, then insists on, a final bet. A map to the wonders of the new world if they win, and the forfeit of all their winnings if they lose. The first scene in every Road to film is dedicated to establishing the duo's contrasting demeanors. Crosby as the callous plan maker who gets the girl, and Hope as the dopey, bright-eyed adventurer. And Tulio and Miguel's inverse reactions as the map is revealed to them serves as a much more effective, much snappier version of this.
A map?
A map?
A map of the wonders of the new world.
Wow.
Establishing their dynamic in like 30 seconds instead of 4 to 600. The boys accept, Curly forces them to use a different pair of dice, and they miraculously still win. As luck would have it, though, the loaded dice from just a moment ago fall out of Tulio's shirt. Huh. This sort of balancing act between divine luck and consummate failure is what the Road to films relied on for subduing a team of characters with unethical ends and transmuting normally sharp-edged, devious remarks or actions into things we can laugh at or feel engaged with in a cautiously optimistic way. Their plans either don't work, which we expect, or do, and we get to laugh at the absurdity of it. Anyways, having now been found out for the swindlers they are, our dysfunctional duo's fight or flight triggers, and without skipping a beat, they spring to life. A variation on Hope and Crosby's patty cake routine. Tulio and Miguel both respond to the revelation that they're cheating, as if neither of them knew they were cheating. One reaches for a guard's rapier, then the other, but he misses. We laugh. Everyone besides them are frozen. The back and forth accelerates. Threaten high, parry high. We chase them across tables. Threaten low, dodge high. Then up to the rooftops. Threaten high, threaten low, parry low. They're revoking Captain Blood, Scaramouche, the court jester, Anne of the Indies. The duo are flinning. As if the film's core elements were not archaic enough, the second our characters turn on, they begin channeling Errol Flynn across Basil Rathbone. And their conclusion of the bit, having successfully evaded the now enthralled mob, bears a striking resemblance to the end of Cleavon Little's self-hostage routine in Blazing Saddles. A few seconds into their backpatting, they realize they've landed in a pen with what looks like Toro the Bull from Looney Tunes. A brilliantly animated chase ensues. Seriously, it is one of my favorite chases in film. And at its climax, the two leap into barrels, are lifted onto Cortez's ship, and our heroes, if we can call them that, have been locked in, quite literally, to the adventure we're about to share. Yes! Finally, I can talk about The Horse. I watched every Road to film for this video, at least twice. Singapore, Zanzibar, Morocco, Utopia, Rio, Bali, Hong Kong, 21 hours and 7 minutes, 76,040 seconds in total, not counting the third watches of the first three of my life spent absorbing this series. And as I came out of my multiple day-long binge and finally watched through The Road to El Dorado again, now intimately familiar with its roots, something began to kind of gnaw at me. There were barely any fourth wall breaks, and I missed them. Every Road to film plays like an elevated caricature of the last. As their humor became more abstract and self-referential, the cast began yelling at the special effects team, taking shots at other actors. Bob Hope literally forces the end card out of frame as the credits roll in Bali and demands to see his agent because he loses L'Amour to Crosby again. But in The Road to El Dorado, the one solid moment of fourth wall breaking dialogue I could put my finger on felt damningly faint in a film which in all other aspects was an exhilarating take on the series' form. And then I hit play again, but this time I tried not to focus on Tulio and Miguel. And it clicked. The fourth wall is broken constantly in the film. It's just not from the characters who can speak. Altivo rolls his eyes to us as Tulio and Miguel melodramatically lament their untimely deaths. He dances to the non-diegetic music of Elton John. He expresses to the camera as if he has a headache when Cortez speaks. He questions how Tulio's voice could echo so much at the entrance to LD. He's even the subject of the only other spoken fourth wall break in the film, an exchange between Miguel and Chell that seems totally innocuous in passing, but is actually an acknowledgement of a continuity lapse when you're paying attention to The Horse. The most consistently emotive, the most sincerely reactive character in our ragtag team of rapscallions is the only one that never has to hide how they feel about the situation, lest they give up the con. And they're almost always just to the side of our focus. Delegating these bits to a nonverbal steed slash sidekick tremendously expedited the payoff of the Road 2's trademark riffs without ever suspending the development of the film's story to reach them. It's ingenious. Speaking of Chell, after the Boys Plus One survived their escape by sea, beautiful, sublime sea. We finally get to meet Chell, our second supporting character and the love interest of the film, rounding out our party for the remainder of the ride. Just like her time-lost counterpart, Dorothy L'Amour, the manner with which we're introduced to Chell is specifically meant to frame her as a helpless victim of circumstance, driven to hitting licks or scamming or whatever by forces external from her and beyond control. So helpless, in fact, that our soft-hearted duo invariably follow her back through whichever threshold she's just emerged from. And therein lies the brilliance of Chell's character. Before we ever learn why she's running or in what context she left the place she's running from, the wounded disposition that she so naturally leads with instantly subdues her audience, making it all the more endearing when it's revealed soon after that she's actually a con artist too. A vastly superior one to either protagonist, wielding the male gaze as a weapon, countering their objectification of her with her own of them, bending anyone who fell for her act to her will, and maintaining that leverage for the remainder of the film. Dorothy was always the steel in the walls of the Road 2's dynamic and structure. The point of the duo being so intrepid yet so bizarre, simultaneously so gifted and so stupid, isn't just slapstick. It is that left to their own devices, death by their own hands is an inevitability. they can never decide their own fates, no matter what. So what better means of making sure they can't than preying on their greatest weaknesses, simultaneously parodying and very earnestly criticizing the way film has treated women, especially women of color. And it's still as topical as ever in El Dorado, since its adversarial mark, Disney, was still in the midst of super hot water for their portrayals of Jasmine, Pocahontas, and Esmeralda being way more sexualized than their Caucasian counterparts, all within the span of like 5 years. Again, not petty at all. What's so interesting about El Dorado, though, is that it was criticized for many of the same things. But if you'll allow me to reach just a tiny bit, I think in this instance it was due to how the film was marketed and the obscurity of its spirit, not necessarily the contents of the work itself. An expectation of honesty where there never was much. The Road to El Dorado is a ton of things, but one thing it is not, at least not fully, is honest. Deliberately so. There's a whole lot of responsibility that inherently comes with portraying a society or a people or a collection of either, especially when they were grievously irreparably harmed, especially when your ancestors perpetuated or profited from that harm. So although the rough outline of the antagonist and the locations and the fauna and the architecture are like basically accurate-ish, everything between those lines is a jumbled mess of different time periods, different cultures, and just plain old characters being wrong. So here's a list of mostly everything the movie goofed up, and then we'll talk about why. Tulio bets Miguel two pesetas that they won't survive their jump, but pesetas weren't used as a form of currency for another 350 years after this. He should have said two real. The thin rapiers the conquistadors wield are cup-hilted and their blades are ductile, developments which didn't exist, especially not commonly, until the early 17th century. Similarly, Mauryan helmets weren't worn by the Spanish until after Cortez and Pizarro's tandem conquests. Cortez threatened to enslave Tulio and Miguel on the sugar plantations of Cuba, but Spain didn't plant sugarcane in Cuba for another 4 years, and it wasn't cultivated regularly or prosperously for another like 200. Cortez says his crew is as carefully chosen as the disciples of Christ, but Christ just asked some people to follow him up a mountain and then pick 12. Cortez's ship has a telescope, but telescopes weren't recorded as an invention until 1608 somewhere in the Netherlands. The city of El Dorado itself is a confused mixture of Aztec, Incan, and Mayan cultures almost solely through the lens of confused and self-lionized Europeans. Xibalba is the underworld of Quiche Mayan mythology, and the architecture mostly adheres to Mayan culture as well, but Hernan Cortez pursued the Aztecs, and the story of Spaniard invaders being falsely welcomed as returning gods was popularized by a priest recounting Francisco Pizarro's reception by the Incan emperor. The same thing was alleged to have happened with Cortez, but it was much less discussed, and in both cases, they were just wrong. Both are myths devised to mask immeasurable wrongdoings. Pizarro wasn't thought of as a returning god. He lured Atahualpa to a feast in his honor and then massacred 5,000 of his soldiers when he refused to accept Charles V as sovereign, then hung him to death after lying to him that he would be spared if he converted to Christianity. I think another fantasy tentpole took inspiration from his brand of cruelty. What I'm getting at here is that's the point. El Dorado in reality was a phantom, a fabrication continuously exaggerated and one-upped by Europeans over centuries to rationalize an actually existent culture, the Muisca's vastly superior metalworking and reverence for gold as a religious votive offering instead of an arbitrary point system that everyone should kill each other over forever and ever. El Dorado doesn't even mean city of gold, it means the golden one, a term the Spanish coined to refer to the southern Muisca's leader, the Zipa, who as an initiation rite was said to have been covered in gold dust and submerged in one of their sacred lakes, most commonly thought to be Lake Guadavida. Over time, the legend changed from a fabled man, to a city, to a kingdom, to an empire, but they were all an illusion. It's like a game of telephone that got really out of hand, and then a Disney competitor and Werner Herzog both made films about it. So when Tulio and Miguel reach the entrance, believing it to be a dead end, and Tulio yells that El Dorado must mean Great Big Rock, that is the filmmakers making fun of how unreliable the history is, because most of it was written by the bad guys. Tulio and Miguel are Spanish and don't know the Spanish title for the Spanish myth that they know about. This is tonal necessity, because like we talked about earlier, the most effective way to blunt the impact of terrible people who did terrible things is to make fun of them. To sap them of whatever divinity or intellect they or their followers or the ones taught by their writings were deluded into believing they had. The Spaniards are supposed to be the butt of the joke, but when the film's marketing run began, DreamWorks, having already struggled with its production for years, initially planning for it to be a PG-13 release and later rescinding it, cutting most of the relationship between Chell and Tullio, forcing a multitude of rewrites as well as nearly the entire film's soundtrack to be scrapped and replaced, the film eventually earning the nickname The Lost City on Hold. The press that they drummed up for El Dorado could not have been more out of sync with what the film was. The few interviews I could find, the profiles, the snippets, carried this kind of self-serious, almost righteous tone, as if because the animation team had visited ruins and Hans had used geographically appropriate instruments and the writers did their research on the region's history, that the film would be putting integrity on the same pedestal as comedy. By the time DreamWorks pivoted to posing the film as a fantasy goof fest, which they should have done from the jump, it was already too late. It is a baffling case of total disconnect, and the initial wave of completely justified backlash considering its presentation irreparably harmed the film's performance and critical reception. It's the only animated film the company ever lost money on. I mean, it didn't even get a Blu-ray release until like this year. And a great deal of writing, even fairly recent writing, criticizes the film from that same perspective. But within the frame of reference that it was meant to be seen through and should have been promoted through from the beginning, The Road to El Dorado is just like its predecessors, criticizing the genre and its competitors' most prolifically problematic tropes with its tongue firmly in its cheek. Like I said, Tullio and Miguel have no control over their own destiny, and the reason for that is because they're an abject criticism of tired white saviorism, finally made aware of the damage they actually cause like 47 minutes into the film. They are on the surface the embodiment of the trope, while simultaneously stumbling through the plot and being shoved in different directions by everyone they attempt to con. Even Altivo. He's the reason they don't have provisions and nearly starve. Tall, Dark, and Handsome here is the reason they flee Spain in the first place. Cortez, the reason they flee the ship. Chell is the reason they barely evade execution, the reason their friendship fractures then reforms, and the reason they win the ballgame, subsequently revealing their mortality to Zekel Khan. Chief Tannenbach instantly sees through their facade and allows them to live out of sympathy. Plus, he literally saves them from and salvages their attempt to save El Dorado, because Tullio, the Galaxy Brain tactician's plan, doesn't go as planned. Even the reason Tullio and Miguel are conmen and thieves in the first place is divulged to us in the most on-the-nose way possible within the first 7 minutes of runtime. The entire intro sequence, from our introduction to Cortez to Miguel and Tullio's escape from his ship, is a poignant illustration of the way imperialist states and the rich within them inherently stand opposed to and criminalize their poor, while simultaneously perpetuating the callousness required to justify, let alone personally amass, that level of wealth. What literally dooms them to torture followed by forever slavery is being crushed, literally, by the riches of those above them. The only meaningful decision Tullio and Miguel ever make on their own is to be pretty okay guys, actually. And to sing. Which is good, because the music in The Road to El Dorado goes crazy. Its sole musical number, what in any other Road to film would be one of at least four or five, is, in a word, euphoric. It is what I would argue to be the centerpiece of the whole film. Its booming percussion, the triumphant brass that comes in for the chorus, the fact that it is the film's only in-universe music featuring lyrics, yet it shows zero interest in serving as an I Want song or any other type of song that could push the story forward in any way, instead electing to be an I guess we should justify committing to the bizarre situation we've fallen into song, are enough by themselves to make me fall in love with the film. And that isn't even considering the beauty of the visuals accompanying it. Elevating El Dorado's already extremely vibrant color palette and distinct art direction into an almost hallucinogenic state, not dissimilar from Dumbo's Pink Elephants on Parade by the time it reaches its end, but with an unparalleled, unbridled energy which Kevin Kline and Kenneth Branagh maintain from the first to last note. But what is perhaps most impressive to me about the Road to El Dorado's soundtrack is that the rest of the songs manage to not fall short of the bar that It's Tough to Be a God sets. It's not another Tarzan, where most of the music, while solid on its own, feels clumsily laid over the film and doesn't land on the emotional beats it seems to be trying to. Another cool YouTube boy, Sideways, has an excellent vid on this that you should check out, but it's like if Tarzan was done right. Every song is written from the perspective of the main characters, with the exception of its introduction, and the film directly interacts with the sentiments they express, either through overt visual cues or characters outright responding to what the song is saying, as is the case with Friends Never Say Goodbye, when the pair take a pause for the titular line to play once more before Miguel says, "Well, good luck," instead of "goodbye," because they still love each other, and I cry. Or the glistening choir in the beginning of Wonders of the New World, swelling into the foreground when the Eldoradians? Eldorites? When the Eldorites heave a waterfall of gold over the two and into Xibalba. The trail we blaze is maybe the perfect tone setter for adventurers setting off into the great unknown, and without question could have topped charts if they released it as an alternative rock single. Speaking of charts, the Backstreet Boys did the backing vocals on Friends Never Say Goodbye. They weren't credited due allegedly to label issues, but the Backstreet stamp by itself is maybe the biggest cinematic flex from the turn of the millennium that I've ever heard. More than just the Road to El Dorado's music, though, I adore its musicality. From the moment we're introduced to the pair, the film hardly ceases its breakneck charge into the unknown, and the few moments which do offer some repose feel almost exactly like the moment in Ennio Morricone's The Ecstasy of Gold, like a minute and 40 seconds in, where everything falls silent, but then you hear the strings start to pick up, and you're like, oh, it's about to go off. The boys are trapped in a cell, but Tullio responds to the brief stagnation by hitting his head against a wall in sync to the strums of a guitar. He is the grounded, percussive constant that holds the excited plucks and strums of Miguel's lute in time. Their interdependence is expressed just like Crosby and Hope's always was, through the music they make. Just as the string section rises back up from the silence in Ecstasy of Gold, so too does the banter in El Dorado, becoming more and more hurried until full lines begin to spill over one another as they argue in front of an audience of strangers, and the film cuts between them, the erupting volcano, and the armadillo and the butterfly it endlessly pursues at their feet, to accentuate the atmosphere of just barely composed chaos until it erupts. That's why they're such excellent flinners. A style of exchanging not impressive swordplay, but impressive wordplay that demands a very specific sense of rhythm that just wasn't common anymore. It's why their arguments never aren't funny, because every aspect of the film, especially its editing, ignores many of the trappings of animated features up to that point. Nothing lingers if not for the emphasis of a pause between two unconvincingly delivered lines, like Miguel slinking out of frame only to jolt back in and double down on his lie about the position of the stars. Every cut feels swift and deliberate, an accoutrement to either the jokes being delivered or the power of each character within their dynamic. The film never once takes an impeded step into the next location. One of my favorite exchanges in the film, when Tullio and Miguel argue about how much they should be worrying, feels closer to the climax of Adam Sandler and Philip Seymour Hoffman's phone argument in Punch Drunk Love than it does to any scene I can think of in an animated feature until the years following LD's release. Cuts on the synchronized action of one and speech of the other, like when Miguel falls in time with Tullio's impatiently growling yes to him.
3 days? Yes!
In tandem with the relentless use of soundbites from slapstick cartoons for even the most blasé of actions, like peeking to see if the shadow priest noticed you definitely giving your fake god/boyfriend a blowjob, give El Dorado an even more infectious and charming comedic cadence than its predecessors. So much of this film is lightning in a bottle. I mean, Speaking of lightning, its visuals in no way fall short of the beauty of its music, its sound design, or its impeccably casted performances. Their choice to color code characters by demeanor, whether they lead with emotion or rationale by the color of their line art, Chell sharing a blue outline with Tulio and Chief Tannenbach, while Miguel, Altivo, and Zekel Khan share the red, and Cortez alone beset on all sides by black, an extension of his detachment from humanity. The ability to believably replicate expressions of confusion, embarrassment, and restrained laughter, like when Miguel nearly breaks character while Tulio is trying to explain, while they'll be ascending horizontally at first. El Dorado's lavish forests and the diversity of its fantastically imagined wildlife. I mean, the road to El Dorado perfected the stylized, angular character design that DreamWorks initially made their mark with in The Prince of Egypt. Their masterfully blended digital animation, giving cities the tremendous populations they should reasonably have, but without obscuring any form or face with broad strokes, simulated focus, or bizarre relative distance, as well as their ability to so vividly depict the properties of gold at a time where no other studio had, enhanced what would already be a breathtaking film into one that was a technical benchmark for its time. It's water. Bewitching azure swells of water. The water is insane. It's mechanically probably the best part of the entire film. DreamWorks developed an all-new program specifically to replicate massive bodies of realistically moving hand-animated water called Spritical, where each sprite and every frame of each cycle could be multiplied onto points in a mesh, replicating a body of water's greater movements. So in scenes like the climax of the film, when Tulio, Miguel, Altivo, and Chell crash their boat into the pillars, propelled by the force of a tremendous violent wave, they're being carried by thousands upon thousands of duplications of a handful of splashes, harmonizing into what is still some of the most convincingly restless and beautiful water in animation. The film's intro ends on a shot of flowing water for no other reason than to flex, because they knew it was that good. I just wish more people had seen it in the same light. This is the film that gave DreamWorks its entire aesthetic formula, paving the way for all of its future successes. I mean, think about it. The protagonist with questionable motives and demeanor, the sardonic, usually animal sidekick who constantly questions these inclinations, the love interest who usually starts out as a begrudging support character whose unconventional personality and abilities are masked beneath a thin veneer of uniformity until the opportunity arises or is forced upon them, the non-diegetic soundtracks littered with charting artists, flagrant celebrity castings. Shrek wouldn't exist without the road to El Dorado. Ants might have given them the more profitable production model, but you couldn't pay Kid Bread to sit through an hour and a half of Zach Braff the Ogre meekly pining for the hustle and bustle of Far, Far Away over a soundtrack of indistinct, nasally trumpets and one keyboard. The road to El Dorado is DreamWorks, at least the elements most crucial to it. I don't think of it as a match made in heaven just because it was the perfect foundation for DreamWorks to build multiple billion-dollar IPs off of, nor do I think it just because the characters and their castings fit one another immaculately. I think of it as a perfect match for me. It's a security blanket, one that I've held onto since my parents brought it home to my sister and I when I was 5 or 6. Tulio, Miguel, Altivo, Chell, Chief Tannenbach, every moment of this film feels like the warmth that washes over you when you hear the voice of an old friend, or the login screen of your favorite WoW expansion, or the drums from your favorite Kanye song, or the laughter from your favorite Let's Play. It was there for me when I was 9 and afraid of the dark, bouncing its vibrant colors off my popcorn ceiling, and it's here for me now when I'm 23. Overwhelmed, burnt out, anxious, and constantly tired. I only actively watched The Road to El Dorado a handful of times before deciding to write about it, but I've listened to it hundreds more, and I think in a lot of ways, the awkward place that it holds in DreamWorks' history is an apt reflection of the kids who grew up watching it. I mean, Its own creators, Elliot and Rossio, ripped it apart in interviews because of how disappointed they were with the way it turned out. Its misleading marketing felt like when you met an old friend of your mom or something, and you're like 12 or 14, and you're getting groceries, and so you're on your way back, and you're in the car, and the only thought your brain can put together is like, why did it feel like you were apologizing for me? I didn't even know those people yet. It's a film centering poor 20-somethings, released in a period of massive economic growth for the country that it was made in, but by the time the kids who watched it became 20-somethings, we had already weathered a major recession and are on the brink of another one. It's a film, in many ways, more concerned with its niche brand of comedy and obscure, antiquated references than it is with placating the taste of the audience given to it. And the film's conclusion concedes that the return home is kind of bullshit now. It doesn't matter, because in their case, and increasingly more in ours, the home that we remember isn't really there anymore to come back to. Even if we did have some magnificent elixir or vast riches to show, the characters in El Dorado itself are simultaneously more and less developed than who and what came before them, constantly grappling with their own cynicism and clumsily falling through life, the film's runtime, seeking refuge in places or people that they fear deep down are ephemeral. The greater conflict is never even resolved, but it's in the wake of our group's flat-on-their-face failure that the warmest hues of the film's light begin to shine through. They might not have a map, and they might not have a plan, but that's what makes it interesting. Maybe some of us feel like half-functioning, maladjusted people like them, only truly confident in their abilities when they feel like they've conned people into thinking they're talented or smart or likable. Maybe it's just me. But its ending, electing to close on such a hopeful, sanguine tone, begs nothing of its audience but to heed their words, to never let failure suspend us from brazenly charging into our futures, eagerly awaiting whatever the next uncalculated, blunder-riddled adventure will be. I don't know. It might be tough to be a god, but it's tougher still to be human. And I think that's the point. Have a good night.
You think that money is everything, and yet it's anybody's friend. Go make a fortune, become a king, and still it's anybody's friend. And if you flash a bankroll, do you suppose the brook would care?
Hey, thanks for watching. Big thank you to my patrons for making this video possible, especially these guys, and a very special thank you to Ericusen, Alexi, Aro Olavi, Altheix, Ask for Seconds, Avid, Blake Demby, Brian Phillips, Buttershield, Charles J. Boyle, Chase Epsi, Diego Eras, Dr. Chike, Eli Zellers, Evan, Gavin Miller, Govels Jack, Grand Shock Trooper, Henry R. Anderson, Ho Shin, I Am Badgers, Ivan Dolvich from Jagged Alliance 2, Jacob New, Joe Betts, Joshua Kodamal, Kane King, Killer Space, Lewi, Long Hyun, Luigi Murray, Marwan Mohammed, Maximum Crash, Max Arndt, Michelle Wen, Mohammed El Zafri, Nick Bell, Robert Whaley, Rory Strickler, Shane Vino, Simon Riley, Straffen Nathan, Travis Osborne, and Tristan Marino. Let me know what you thought about what I thought down below. Make sure to like and subscribe if you feel like seeing more slick vids like the one you just watched, and if you really want to help out, consider becoming a patron. Every penny helps me try to make this thing a full-time gig. Anyways, love you, and I'll see you next time.
It's anybody's friend.